Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the SVA Lumen Art Panel, Finding Your Voice as a Digital Artist. I'm here with Carla Rapoport and Meng Chiang, and we're very excited to talk to you today. I'm your host and moderator, mainly because I had invited Carla to come in person and do a semblance of this in New York City at SVA. On stage in front of a live audience. But of course we couldn't do that because we had it planned for March, I guess, or April. So that didn't work out, but I was very happy to accept Carla's invitation and CADAF to do this way. So it'll be great. So just I'm going to do a brief introduction of why we're doing this and the School of Visual Arts, where I'm the chair of the MFA Computer Arts Department, a two-year MFA in the heart of New York City's Chelsea neighborhood. But first, I do want to thank CADAF and their whole team for this opportunity. I look forward to watching myself when this is broadcast at a slightly later date, and I believe we're going to try to do a live Q&A answer chat while that's being broadcast. So look forward to that. And Julia for the tech side. But I'm very pleased and excited to introduce Carla Rapoport and Meng Chiang, who's our class of 2013, right?
Yes. Meng? Yeah. Yeah.
Right. And a Lumen long list member from 2015, which is how Carla knows her from Lumen. I'm going to start off. So hopefully everyone knows about the School of Visual Arts and SVA. But I'm going to share my screen and show a 30-second video of some of the recent works by my students that hopefully will show a pretty wide gamut of what we do, which is 2D and 3D art, fairly production oriented, you know, winning Academy Awards and working in animation studios, but also experimental art, which is what I'm going to focus on here, which really includes all manner of gallery installation, real-time graphics, virtual reality, gaming, mixing up all kinds of fine and experimental art. So I'm going to do that now. I'm going to share my screen and show a 30-second video and then come back. Here we go. And share. And play. Stop. Am I back?
Yep.
Okay, I'm back. Oh, I gotta play. Did everyone hear the audio for that, I hope?
No.
No.
Oh, that's too bad. All right. I'll show it at the close and hit another button. Because as filmmakers, as storytellers, we all know audio is sometimes 50% of the experience. I get that from my old boss, George Lucas. So just a little bit more about my program, and then I'm going to turn it over to Carla, and she's going to tell us all about the Lumen Prize and the Lumen Art Projects. So I took over about 4 years ago at MFA Computer Arts. It was MFA Computer Art, singular, when I took it over, at its 30th anniversary. So the department had been in existence for 30 years. We're one of literally the first digital art master's programs in the country. And it was one of the first things I did with the rebranding when I took over as chair to add an S to the program, computer arts, because I felt there was so much involved with the variety of technology, of storytelling, of media, that was just a little bit more inclusive. It may seem like a small thing, but hopefully that'll be part of our moderating panel discussion at the end about the arts, plural, collaboration and all that. And Finding Your Voice is a title that I came up with to encapsulate the discussion of the individual artist. And I think it started off well. I did the first of one of these in-person discussions with a filmmaker at SVA. And since everyone is an individual, this finding your voice, I think, was a good a label to try to talk about. So that's why we named it this. And finally, when I get to talk about some of our work, you'll hear me saying experimental art as opposed to fine art. So when I took over, and just a quick interruption, is anyone else getting a little echo? If I don't know if there's any microphones unmuted, I'm getting a little thing in the background. Hopefully that's be okay on the recording. So when I took over the program, it was 2D animation, 3D animation, and fine art. And I changed the name to experimental art as an informal label within the department. Again, just to better describe what we were doing. To me, as a fine artist, in my BFA and MFA programs, fine art to many, maybe old school people with gray hair like me, it means sculpture and painting and things like that. So to me, experimental art was more what we were doing, introducing real-time graphics and haptic touch-sensitive projection mapping. And Meng is going to show you about some of her work. So, but with that, I think I want to turn it over to Carla now, and hopefully that gives you some background of me and SVA and how this panel came apart. After Carla and then Meng speak, we'll have a panel discussion about this. So, Carla, you want to take it from here?
Thank you so much, Terrence. That was great. Really wonderful introduction to both the panel and to SVA. I'm the executive director of Lumen Art Projects, a UK-based nonprofit that produces and curates exhibitions, commissions, and events using art that intersects with science and technology. And my partnership with SVA goes back to, I think, 2014, where I met Bruce Wands, who was a predecessor of Terrence. And it's been fabulous to have the entries every year from SVA students. And of course, we'll be hearing from Meng later, but one of the very first images you showed on your video was a Lumen shortlisted artist who we showed. That was a still from one of our Lumen shows of her work, the first time she'd been shown abroad, I think maybe even anywhere, in Somerset here in the UK. So very excited to be here. Our network of more than 400 artists globally is drawn from our annual juried competition, the Lumen Prize for Art and Technology. And it was launched in 2012. And every year, artists who are longlisted, shortlisted, or who win an award are immediately eligible for opportunities with Lumen Art Projects, which it develops with its partners worldwide. I'm proud to say, as I just mentioned, that one of our partners is SVA, and another now is CADAF, and we're involved in 4 or 5 talks in this art fair. Thrilled to be involved. It wasn't the art fair that we'd all been planning for, but in many ways, it has a more exciting edge to it, and I think it has real possibilities of opening up our genre to even wider audiences, which is nothing wrong with that. That is just fabulous. So I'd like to speak for a few minutes about our own commitment to developing talent in the genre of art and tech using Terrence's title, Finding Your Voice, and by talking through a few slides of some events and activities that we've done with young artists. So looking at this slide, we're now at Goldsmiths University in January, and in the corner there, you can see two of our artists, Amanda Baum and Rose Leahy, who qualified in 2019, speaking about the post-human and the future of biotech. I didn't make that up. So our artists go down all sorts of rabbit holes, and these two are experts on how art intersects with our own biology. I would really encourage all of you who are listening, who are aspiring young artists yourself, to get out there and overcome any fears of public speaking. It's at events like these that you'll meet your fans, you'll make new fans, and hear what other artists are doing. We do about 10 events a year. I was going to be doing one with Terrence in the spring. And when the world comes back to right, we're hoping to do more. In the meantime, these virtual ones are also a terrific platform for people looking to find their voice. And the next slide is an example of the kind of projects that Lumen gets involved in. This was an artist who qualified in 2016, and he works with lasers and music and light. And the partnership here is an unusual one. We were partnering with one of the largest urban redevelopment projects in London, in Europe. It's in East London. And this commission was made possible by working with these groups of businesses to develop a weekend exhibition that involved all age groups to play with the lasers and the light and the music. The beauty of art and tech, I feel, is that it's not dependent on the traditional spaces of museums and galleries, and it can go literally anywhere and is uniquely engaging to new audiences. This is what's drawn me to it, and this is what the kinds of partnerships that define Lumen, looking for different places to go. On our next slide, this really is a very different place to go. This is St. Petersburg. And another aspect of our world is the festivals that we attend. And this is a festival that's put on every year by Cyland Media Fest, based in both St. Petersburg and New York. They do amazing work, and we were thrilled to partner with them. And again, for artists looking to find their voice, I mean, you can come along as a Lumen artist if you become part of our community, or you can just apply to these festivals yourself. They are all over the place, and they're happily, they're growing. So the next slide is one of our partners here in the UK. This is the Eureka, it's called Eureka, the National Children's Museum in Halifax, where we've provided over 20 interactive art experiences from artists worldwide out of our Lumen community. This is a still from an interactive immersive art experience called Microworld, which is the subject of another Lumen art talk with CADAF, should you wish to listen in. The point I'd like to make here about finding your voice as a young artist is that think about new audiences and different age groups and how different age groups might enjoy your work and how interactivity brings in more people who can find you. This is a piece that uses you can see the little squidlet on the screen, so it uses your face to create a piece of animation that goes into the artwork. So this is gives you an idea of the breadth of some of the artists we work with. My next slide is highlighting a show that opened in mid-June, In Real Life, featuring last year's Gold Award winner, Riffy Gunadal, and our still image winner, Sugwen Chung. Winning a prize does get you noticed. This is a show that is currently on and running in a Norwegian museum in Kristiansand, Norway. So again, thrilled to have that partnership with a traditional museum that's experimenting with work in this area, and excited to be part of that network with this show opening in a country that has reopened. The last slide is for an event that is a partner network of ours. It's not part of the Lumen network, but it's one of our partners. And the reason I put it in here is that they've managed to connect to one of the largest galleries in the UK, the National Gallery of Art. And the point I wanted to make is that traditional galleries are starting to reach out. They need to improve their outreach to younger artists, to artists of color, and artists in the LGBTQ community. So don't be shy and don't be afraid of sending those emails to even the most traditional names in the art world. They are starting to look at you. So that pretty much wraps up my comments, Terrence, if you want to take over again as moderator. I'll come back in for the panel.
Excellent. Thank you, Carla. So it's my pleasure now. We've already introduced Meng, one of our distinguished alumni and a great representative of ours in the international art community. She's just a great typical example of the wonderfully brilliant artists that have an independent voice and is just a great representative for us. So I'm very grateful, Meng, that you took time away from your busy freelancing schedule and can talk about your work. So Meng, please, I can't wait to see what you're going to show.
Okay, thank you, Terrence, and thank you, Carlos, for the amazing introductions. So I am a digital artist, and I'm also a UI and UX designer in New York. And now I'm going to show you one of my experimental work that I did in SVA. I will give you a little background about how I want to do this project. Before I come to New York, I do a lot of commercial work in the company. And after I come to the SVA computer art, and I found I really want to do some experimental data arts or very fun installations. So I will share the screen about some images that I made. And then I will show the demo of my work. So this word in the screen you see right now is called A Stranger to Word, because English is my second language. So I wish to tell my own stories, and I want to express how I get into the New York life and how I have adapted to the West culture. So right now it's a data visualization. It's the final format that I can show you. It has a lot of different visuals, but it's all represented the same data. That is all the category that I read for the first year when I'm in New York. So it's kind of frustrating, it's kind of difficult, but in the end, I transformed that into the art form. So it's like kind of like an art therapy to me, and I would like to share my vulnerabilities to everyone's. And at the beginning that I feel very shy and feel very uncomfortable, but in the end, I'm very happy to see the outcomes that you have seen here. And I will share a documentary video. It's about 4 minutes. So I hope the video will work. Let me share that again. Video. Is the audio work?
Yeah, I can hear it.
Okay, cool.
Yes.
So it's about data visualization, about how I learned English. So I record all the category words that I read, and I make my own database. So basically that is my daily life. That is the first learning process in here. And this is one of my notes.
I have a very large scale, high resolution print of that work outside my office in the hallway.
Yeah. So one word will connect to 4 dots, which is all their learning property, like unknown syllables, length. And this is the property one, like occurrence one. So all the words occurrence once, it will link to these properties. And this is the posters for the whole word that I collect. So it's a pretty long, it came from ceiling to the bottoms is a long posters. So I do a lot of data analysis in the beginnings in the Excel.
Who knew Excel could be so creative?
And this is the graphy, which I use it to create the shape and the color and the different creations. This is the graphy softwares. And then I write some PHP and HTML in order to put it online.
Meng, are these still live on your website that people can interact with? Good.
Right. So I will show you lately.
Just so that people can visit there after our talk and experience it themselves.
Yeah.
Have you provided this, or is it possible to see this in a 3D spatial volume with virtual reality? Have you thought about that?
Yeah, I thought about that. I wish I can create it for 3D in the future. Okay, stop share. So Terrence just mentioned that it has a website. Yeah, so I will show you the website right now. It's actually very simple link. It's just called A Stranger to Words. This then is the title of the work. So I think it's...
And I hope when this is broadcast, we can have a compendium somewhere. We can share links and contacts and URLs like this to make sure people can find them okay.
Yep. So here's the URL. Can everybody see my screen here? Mm-hmm. Yep. So a stranger to word.com, and I put my artwork just here. So originally it's just internet art. So everyone can access to this link and interact with this work. And then you can see this is the whole database, but when you just roll over a property, for example, syllable ones, you can get a total new visuals in the website. So original, that is one, but you can create and interact with thousands or hundreds of images that you like. So it's pretty simple that I can zoom in to see, you know, all the words that I read. So here is all the words, and actually you can read the words so you can understand which topics I liked and which articles that I read. It's very personal database, but I kind of just want to express my life and my story. So I choose to recreate my own database, just more fun and more personal. And this is the length 7, that all the words include 7 letters will link to these properties. So you can zoom in and zoom out to interact with the website. And I have 4 visuals. They are different like colors and the shade, but the database are the same, just explores the learning process that I imagined. So I like 4 of them. Actually, I can create thousands of them, but these 4 are the most favorites of my trying. So I like to present this. Okay. So if you have the link, you can definitely go to see and interact with this website, and you can figure out the surprisingly interactive visuals inside these websites. And so this is that. Okay.
Can't wait to try this out myself interactively.
Yep. So that's pretty much my work, and I will turn you to Terrence to continue our panel discussion.
Excellent. This is what I've been looking forward to. I love talking with you both about these topics. For our audience around the world, what we're going to do now is take some time, about 20 minutes or so, and have an open discussion about these topics and more. And I thought I'd start off with... I love Carla's point that she just made a few minutes ago about the fact that experimental art, and this art by any name, can go anywhere and can be experienced anywhere. I think that's really key, combined with, for lack of a better word, today's new normal. We all know the the harsh reality we've been forced upon us, first with COVID and now with the equality issues and demonstrations around the whole world. So what I'd like to do maybe is start the discussion off combining those two issues about staying positive, making new opportunities, and standing out. I think that's a great way to start talking about embracing these limitations. I've been talking with my new incoming class of 50 plus international students that are going to come to SVA in the fall. Hope that they can be part of, like Meng has, freelancing, to be part of the better part of change, right, in this time. So maybe Meng, you can start talking about that just briefly about the current reality of being a very successful freelancer, right, with your own voice internationally. Maybe tell us a little bit about that. What's changed in the last 3 months and how others can be successful?
Yep. Actually, after I graduated, I have been full time for about 5 years because I need to get the working visas. So if you are an artist, you need to get an O1, which is artist visa, or you need to be hired by a company to get an H1B. That's what I did. And after I got the green card, I want to do more of my own work, my personal projects. So I just switched to freelancing job and I create my own business and find my studio. So right now I have my team and I have the time to, you know, go to Europe for conference or go back to Hong Kong or Japan for a lot of festivals. I quite like the life that right now. After COVID, I think all of my schedules are kind of mixed and I can't fly it anymore. But I found that I have saved a lot of time because before I used to go to the airport or using a lot of time in transportation, but right now I save the time. And during these times, I focus on creating a new art and a new installation that I like. I found that this is really important for every artist. So no matter you are a full-time freelancing or you have your own business, just don't stop to continue creating art and do some experimental. I think that is really important.
Yeah, couldn't agree more. Maybe Carla can pick that up and talk about the importance of networks, we were saying, right, to sure, stay connected and become connected.
Sure. Well, for us, interestingly, the discussion had begun before COVID, as I'm sure it had for you both, on the excessive amount of travel that our world has and the impact that's been having on the planet. Yep. So one of the artists whose slides I show, who's being shown in Norway, had already started to develop a telepresence project that she could perform in her studio in Brooklyn, in New York. And it would be telepresenced live to an audience in Norway. And then COVID happened. And instead of her going to show it and then doing the telepresence later, she hasn't traveled. The opening has already happened by the time this broadcast goes out. And she will have created a telepresence performance that interacts with the audience that's in the museum in Norway. So the attendees will be there and there will be a way for her computer to interact with computers there to pick up on their movement and make this as part of her performance. Now, who could have come up with that without the imperative of our new world? So in a funny way, we're generating ideas that will help our environment when we come out of lockdown. So I'm not saying it's generated a lot of opportunities. Obviously, it's closed down so many hundreds of thousands of opportunities, particularly in the performing arts. But in our world, in digital world, there are ways that we can help and ways that we can put ideas forward that can help venues engage with audiences globally. This fair, this CADAF fair, if it had been in Paris, would have been restricted to the people who got to Paris. But this way, this fair is engaging with people all over the place. So, and I find that I have to take that to heart as something encouraging. You mentioned networks, and networks, of course, are key. I mean, Meng is being very kind of modest about the fact that she just picked up and moved into freelance. I mean, you must have an incredible network. And I feel that being able to reach out to others in our field, connecting to partnerships and building partnerships, is really key to how art and technology also is able to have legs and develop. Don't you feel, Meng, that, I mean, I'm interested in some of the networks you engage with. For us, it's,
Yeah, so I think SVA have a strong communities in New York and especially in the US. So I got a lot of help from our the people who have studied here, and they help us to find the opportunities. So I think the SVA community definitely helped me a lot. And after that, I start to attend a lot of festival and a conference, and I know a lot of artists. Also give me a lot of opportunity to, you know the work, know the technologies, and know the artworks. So I think it's definitely, I build out my connection from computer arts, and then I expand my connections to the conference and the festivals. I think that is more important. So I will encourage people to attend a lot of awards, festival or conference, and to know everyone there, and maybe you can share insights and inspired by each other, and you can make your own art from there. So that's pretty much how I did. It's quite simple. It's quite everyone did, but just shares my connection work.
Well, one thing I'd like to emphasize too, for maybe younger people who are just starting out, is the very altruistic, open, friendly personality that our community embodies. Including the three of us, I don't think we're atypical, right? Everyone who's successful in this business, with very, very rare exception, would love to hear from people. You know, connect with us after this talk through LinkedIn is the typical professional connection, right, facilitator. Email anyone that you admire, and especially today through vehicles like Instagram and Twitter and LinkedIn, no matter who they are, no matter how many millions of followers they may have, don't be put off, right? Just ask people for their advice. Be humble, right? You'd be amazed at how willing people are to say, I'd love to look at your portfolio and give you some feedback, right? Oh, I'd love to introduce you to that person that you want to know.
And the other thing about technology is it's a moving target. It's always changing. And sometimes it's the youngest players that have the best grasp on what is the latest business in technology. So older players might want the refresh that a younger artist can provide. And so in technology moves so quickly. And it's also an interesting game in art and tech because isn't so gallery dependent. Galleries don't really understand technology by and large. There are a few, one or two, maybe three, but by and large, the traditional big galleries don't really get this world. So by learning your craft, you become your own gallery in the sense of knowing your tool sets and knowing who supports those tool sets out in the world. And you build your network that way. And basically the big artists that win the Lumen Prize or the artists that go on from winning the Lumen Prize, I don't see them signing up with galleries. I see them working with partnerships, commercial partnerships all around the world themselves, representing themselves. So what Terrence is saying is really good advice. Reach out and then continue to reach out no matter where you are at your stage in your career, because it isn't necessarily true that the contemporary art world is going to have a place for you to bring you on the way it had traditionally done for the so-called fine arts that you were talking about earlier. I wonder if you agree with that, Meng and Terrence.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more. It actually brings up a topic I'd love to get both of your opinions on. There's a phrase that I've been told by my students over the last decade or so that is one of the most memorable of my teaching points, according to them, that when they say, well, how do I get a job? How do I be successful? How do we go out into the big wide world? And my soundbite that they remember is I say, well, just be better than everybody else. And then of course that needs an hour long follow-up explanation and discussion about it. It's not an ego trip. It's not a literal, it's an aspiration that you should embrace all these opportunities and say, well, what do I have to do to stand out, to the points that you just made, to connect with people, to put my voice forward, and, you know, break that normal curve, because there's so much mediocrity out there. If someone does stand out, even just a little bit, it's really easy. In the end, it is easy to get noticed. It may seem absolutely daunting to someone young or just starting out, right? That it's just, how can I compete? You know, there's millions of brilliant artists and technologists out there. How could I possibly get noticed? And that's how you do it. You just be better than everyone else, and people. So tell me what you think about that phrase, because it can be controversial. It can be seen as very, you know, egotistical and anti-collaborative, but that's not how it's meant to be perceived.
Well, I guess I see it as being, have your own unique selling proposition. I mean, be the best you can in what is unique to you, and only you can define that. No one else can define it for you. And Meng did a beautiful presentation of what's unique to her use of words and language and understanding how it connects to this beautiful linear landscape that she's, this world she's created for herself. And then she shared it for free online for people to come and look at it. I mean, that is the most generous and most amazing way of being her best self. I think it's a good phrase. It is a little controversial, because it does sound a little pushy, but I think it is a good phrase.
Yeah.
It's true.
Yeah, and I also think that I think better than everyone is a good directions. And I also think that people who want to do an excellent designer or to do a digital artist, they want to know, they want to create a better self. For example, you need to get the better, like you need to improve yourself, no matter in your skills, in your presentation, in your personalities. That I think the better self is definitely before the better than everyone. And then if you find the true self, your work will be more authentic, will be more touching, and it tell your story. So I think find yourself and try to explain that. Don't be afraid to hide yourself. And I think that will help to, you know, find your voice and to that everybody know you, because everyone is unique and everyone's story is just, you know, just the only things in the world. So I think I will, when I see the artworks, I will know the artist's story, the artist's background. I think that is more intriguing me, and I will find if they do that, they are better than anyone else.
Yeah, that's very well said. And you just said something that's another very core, important teaching point of mine about not being afraid to fail. That can have such a strong impact on students who are either, well, lots of emotions, you know, hesitant or questioning their own validity. But I think once an artist, an individual gets over that hesitancy, that fear of failure, it can be empowering and illuminating, right? It just can be a brilliant thing to redefine your own limitations and to discover happy accidents. That's another phrase that comes up. You know, if you're not going to be experimenting and iterating and tweaking and failing and restarting, you're not going to discover these happy accidents.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. That's why I like SVA, because all the staff or the faculty are encourage us to fail, and everyone just find a lot of happy accidents, and we just create a lot of amazing work that we never thought before. I think that is very good environments for people to create their work.
Yeah, and maybe that's I know we're coming up on 45 minutes or so, but maybe we can close a little bit by talking about a collaboration. We haven't touched on that too much. But there's always the balance of finding your voice, your individuality, your inner passion that drives everything you do, but all of the advantages and the wonderful, beautiful opportunities that happen when you collaborate while maintaining your inner voice. I know, Carla, certainly you've seen that at every level with Lumen.
Absolutely. I would say at least half, if not more than half, of those who succeed to make it onto the long list, short list, or win an award are collectives, at least half. And a lot of them, I was thinking about this while you were speaking, Meng, a lot of them met at university, at their master's program. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. they formed partnerships there that have lasted for 10, 15, 20 years. And it started off, I think, because one would be the sort of fine artist and the other would be the tech geek. And that was kind of the history of it. But it's certainly broadened out now. And now collectives, they might have a graphic design studio and then an art aspect to that graphic design studio bolted on, or projects they do that way. But I, from where I sit, it can be a really useful entry point if you're thinking about getting into digital art or art and technology, is to think about pairing up with someone. I think it's something to think about, those in the audience who are thinking they might like to dip a toe in. That's a nice way, a nice entry point. And there are also ways of being in a collective and having your own individual practice. So I think there are many ways of looking at it. How about you? How do you see it?
Yeah, before I always work by my own, but recently I have a lot of large scale projects, so I have to collaborate with a lot of people. For example, if I have a show, I will have curators, I will have the interior designer to help me build the exhibitions. So I think the collaborative skill, how you need to express your idea, how you need to organize everything, is a key skill to every artist. And you know, you can learn a lot from others. I think I always learned a lot from the engineer, from the project manager, and I think through the collaboration definitely just enhance my ability and just let me know more about how to expand my ability and how to create more work. So that's what I learned.
That's a great way to approach our time limit. That balancing the individual and the striving to be better than everyone else, with being humble, right, and accepting and embracing communication and input from everyone, whether it's the technician installing your work or your mentor that you've been admiring for 30 years. That's a wonderful sentiment. Do we want to have any closing words from both of you, perhaps? Anything we haven't touched on? And we'll have hopefully live Q&A to answer people's questions while this is broadcast by CADAF. And thanks again for them for hosting this.
I guess I'd just like to make, we've just closed the ninth call for entries for the Lumen Prize, but I'd like to make a little pitch for next year's, which will open in the new year, and hope to continue getting fine work from SVA. And those of you who haven't heard from the Lumen Prize, haven't heard of it before, I hope you'll have a look on the website and see what we do at Lumen Art Projects, which is the network of the artists who qualify. But thank you for giving me a chance to say that at the end, Terrence.
Of course. How about you, Meng? Want to tell us about your latest project, or how people can get in touch with you and follow your work?
People can find my work on my website, menchi.com, and I hope I can have more artwork to attend the Lumen Art Project next year, so we can all go to London and see each other in person. I think that is very important. I miss everyone, so video call is pretty well, but I think it's better than meeting in person, right? So I think that is my, I think that's what I want to do in my next year.
Great. Excellent. Well, yeah, thank you both very much again. Thank you, CADAF, and everyone there for facilitating this. And for my closing words, I echo Meng's where I can't wait to see everyone in person. And anyone hearing this, please come to New York City, or if you're in New York City, come visit me and the School of Visual Arts in Manhattan. And I guess that's it. That was brilliant. Thank you both very much. I enjoyed that thoroughly. I hope
thank
it was
you
very
so
useful.
Much.
Thank you. That was really good.